Hello, everyone. Welcome to the ICIEV and IVPR lecture series, number four by Professor Anton Nyholt. He's a very well-known guy and a big professor of at the University of Twente, the Netherlands. And he's a wonderful friend of mine. I am extremely delighted to have him today. And his topic is embodied humor, comedy, and social robots. Professor Anton, he has published a great number of papers and books as well. And he's extremely well-known in the this community and very well-respected. And I really love him, and we are very grateful to have him in our lecture series today. So without any further delay, I mean, I would like to request my great friend, Anton Nyholt, to start his presentation. You can take as long as you want. Don't hesitate about time. I think 1 hour you can finish, and then we can have question and answer. So it's totally up to you. Thank you so much. Please, Anton.
Okay, thank you very much for this kind introduction. Well, of course, I'm saying this rather often these days. It's a pity I cannot be there. I can't be there. So, but to all my friends in Japan, in Bangladesh, probably also in India, I see someone from India too. Good afternoon or good evening in Japan. Well, my talk is about humor, embodied humor, comedy, and social robots. Probably 45, 50 minutes, I think. These are some of my interests. So I'm very much interested in playful applications of information and communication technology. So playable or playful interfaces, playable cities, things like that. But today I will focus on robots, performance robots that are using humor on stage or in movies. And okay, I have a few subtopics, so I will start with some early performance robots. Then I will talk about humans simulating robotic behavior, about double acts, especially from Japan, stand-up comedy, then some notes on non-verbal and audience interaction, also on stage, humor, of course, and I have some conclusions. So let's start with this quotation. My dear Miss Glory, robots are not people. They are mechanical. They are more perfect than we are. They have an astounding intellectual capacity, but they have no soul. They learn to speak, write, and do arithmetic. They have a phenomenal memory. So if one read the 20-volume encyclopedia, for example, the Encyclopedia Britannica, they could repeat everything back in order, but they never think up anything original. They'd make fine university professors. So I hope you are not offended by this last sentence. This is a quote. It's coming from a book. And this year, 2020, it's 100 years ago that this book appeared, and also in the same period. So September, October, early November. And it's a book by Karel Čapek. In fact, it's a play. Čapek is a playwright. And the book title is Rossum's Universal Robots. And you see the front page and the cover. And because it's 100 years ago, I think it's a good time to, well, pay some extra attention to what Karel Čapek did with robots on stage. So 100 years ago, he had this stage performance. You also see the poster. The poster and the stage performance was in 1921. And well, it was in fact the first time that the word robot appeared in the literature and also in the world. So a nice opportunity to celebrate with this talk, this 100th year appearance of the word robot in the world. I will have some notes about early performance robots, and I will start again with this so-called Ruhr robot. Well, it was not a robot. On stage, it was played by humans. So they had special clothing, so they looked a little at what they assumed a robot should look like. They had mechanical movements. So it premiered in Prague, 1921. 30 translations already available 2 years later. It was performed on stage in Berlin, in Tokyo. There was a BBC radio show devoted to it. And it also appeared on television in 1938. I will come back to that later. The robots were a little, well, let's say aggressive, not always friendly. So here are two quotes. The robots remember everything, but that's all they do. So they don't laugh at what people tell them. And only robots don't feel pleasure. There's nothing they are interested in. It's not as if anyone's ever seen a robot laugh. So these were universal robots, and they revolted against humanity at a certain time during the play. So they revolted against their masters. And in order to prevent something like that, they thought maybe we should not have universal robots, but we should make national robots. So that one nation can fight another nation with robots and they don't revolt against humanity and against their masters. So that sounds rather, well, familiar maybe. Some years later, Fritz Lang, a movie director, he had the movie Metropolis, 1927. And also in this movie, there was a robot. And again, the robot was not really friendly. So there was some struggle in the factories, and the robot tried to help the factory workers in their struggle against their masters, against the factory. But at the end, things turned around and the robot was burned. And you see the designer of the robot, at least in the movie over here. And he said, give me another 24 hours and no one will be able to tell a machine man from a mortal. So he was very optimistic about robots. This Ruhr robot, well, it drew attention also in Japan, I mentioned it. But there they built a more friendly robot. It was called Gakuten Soku. And it had to learn from the rules of nature. So it was a friendly robot. So it meant they spent a lot of time on the head and the face and the facial expressions. So it could smile, it could turn its head, etc. And again, a lot of people were interested. So it was showed, it was presented during exhibitions and things like that. In the United States, 1928, the Westinghouse Company built a robot. Well, in fact, they had some kind of switch station device to control an electric substation. But because of its assumed intelligence, people called it a mechanical man. And then after some time, they really made an effort to make it look like a human being. So the robot could talk a little, it could vacuum clean the house, it could raise a flag. And what I said, a lot of publicity was there, for example, in the Atlanta Journal. And there on the right of the sheet, you can see this quotation again, this text, even so mechanical, he'd be an improvement on a lot of our stage acts. So maybe this is the first appearance that people were thinking about having a robot perform as some kind of comedian or as an actor on stage. And it should be an improvement on what they were seeing during these days. Well, there were a lot of other countries where they introduced these mechanical robots, and usually they were transported with a truck from one exhibition to another exhibition. So this is an example from Cuba, but you also have examples from United Kingdom, more examples from the United States, from France, from Germany. This robot could shake hands, it could smoke, it could turn around, and it could walk or at least roll from one position to another position. The Westinghouse robot was really made into a human-like representation. So you see it here on the left. And well, we can see if you have your sound ready, you can hear it. You can hear the robot talk.
Start, please. 2. Me?
Yes, you.
Okay, Toots. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll be very glad to tell my story. I am a smart fellow, as I have a very fine brain of 48 electrical relays. It works just like a telephone switchboard. If I get a wrong number, I can always blame the operator.
Okay, you see that also these early robots were making jokes in conversations, and the audience loved that. So the robot could walk, it could count, it had phone recordings that could be played on these 78 revolutions per minute recordings. Ruhr, this robot that was introduced by Karel Čapek, also appeared in a movie in the USSR, so in Russia we call it now, in 1935. So let's have a look at what this robot is doing.
Универсальный рабочий Рипля. Рур. Точно. Сила. И быстрота реакции. Сегодня звук и радиоволна. Завтра речь и моя мысль. Мы, так как процесс мышления, тоже материал.
Okay, that was the Ruhr robot, a little different from what Karel Čapek had in his play. As I mentioned, there was a television broadcast, BBC, in 1938, and it was rebroadcasted in 1948. So you see a nice picture of this broadcast in 1938. And now let's go from this 1938 movie to some more recent appearances of robots in movies. And then, of course, my focus is on robots that have a humorous role in these movies. So in the 1950s, 1960s, then you had, for example, the Forbidden Planet movie in the United States. It had a robot called Robbie, Robbie the Robot. You probably know Space Odyssey from Stanley Kubrick, the HAL robot, H-A-L, 1968. The R2 robot, it's from George Lucas' Star Wars. And then in Star Trek, you had Commander Data. It was an android, so some kind of human-like robot, 1988. So here you have Robbie the Robot. He appeared, or it appeared in many movements. R2 in Star Wars and Space Odyssey. It's nice that the movie, it was based on a book by Arthur C. Clarke. And Arthur C. Clarke was sometimes called, well, can a computer have consciousness? And what he said, and that's in this quotation, well, if it shows really genuine sense of humor, then I would decide it was conscious. It should be able to tell jokes, to make jokes, and make jokes at its own expense. And Commander Data from the Star Trek movies, well, he was very well known because he didn't understand emotions. He didn't have emotions. He didn't know about humor. So during one of these movies, they tried to learn him, to teach him humor. So here is a very nice clip from the outrageous Okona movie, 1988.
So, you agree with Okona that I am missing a very important human factor.
I never said that. I simply said that I've never seen you laugh.
I am capable of that function when it is expected of me.
David, do you even know what a joke is?
Of course I do. It is a witticism, a gag, a bon mot, a fluctuation.
Stop. Look, it's just you and I here. We're talking, we're having an intimate conversation. Why? Because you're a droid and I'm annoyed.
But why?
Because that's what I am.
Have I said something to offend you?
No.
Then why are you annoyed?
Because you're a droid and I'm annoyed.
Humanoid?
Yes.
You told a joke?
Yes.
I am not laughing?
Yes.
Perhaps the joke was not funny.
No, the joke was funny. It's you, David.
Are you sure?
Yes.
I agree. What do I do?
Well, under normal circumstances, I'd say seek a higher power. But in your case, probably a smarter computer's in order.
Computer, I wish to know more about humor. Why certain combinations of words and actions make humans laugh?
Source material on that subject is extensive. Please specify.
Animated presentation, humanoid, interaction required.
Physical humor, cerebral or general
Okay, as I said, in fact, this movie shows it all. You need computers, you need smarter computers in order to explain what is humor. In later movies, so the 2000 movies, well, there are a lot of them, especially, of course, the Star Wars movie. They have wonderful robots, and sometimes they express humor, often ironic or sarcastic humor. We also have artificial intelligence, the movie. iRobot is well known, the Wall-E movie with a humorous robot called Wall-E. Interstellar, of course. A little more about Interstellar will come later. Here you have artificial intelligence, so the boy is in fact an android. iRobot, movie with director Alex Proyas. It is the Sony robot, if I remember well. And Interstellar, Christopher Nolan, 2014. There are, of course, more movies. One well-known movie, maybe, is Woody Allen's sleeper movie, which is some kind of parody, at least part of the movie, a parody on the Space Odyssey movie with the Hell robot. Interstellar. Well, you can see it over here, so. Therefore, stage one separation. Stage one. There it is, Martin. Everybody good? Plenty of slaves from our robot colony? Okay, so they're really talking about a robot having a sense of humor. So it's not necessarily about jokes. Jokes are maybe, well, there was an example of a joke in this interaction, but having a sense of humor is something different, is something more than just telling jokes. On stage, we have humans simulating robot behavior. So I won't talk about this person sometimes. He's really looking like a robot, as a robot, Mark Zuckerberg. But on stage, Alan Ayckbourn, it's a British playwright, director, and he had several plays in which robots were performing. Again, robots were played by human beings and they became humorous just because they were so clumsy. They made errors. Their behavior was mechanical. They were absent-minded. They didn't have any knowledge about the world. So for example, putting a baby in a microwave was rather normal for a robot. Things like that were happening, and then of course in a humorous way. There were comedians mimicking robots, so on stage we had these performers that mimicked robots, but also let's say stand-up comedians mimicking robots. So let's focus on Mr. Seth, the robotic comic, and here you have a short clip of his performance.
Hey, Ted. Hi, how are you?
Nice to see you.
Yeah. Nice to see you, Rich.
Nice to see you.
Hi, how are you?
Abby. Always a pleasure to be here with you, Abby Lee.
Thank you.
Shall we sit down, Ted?
Why don't we, Ted?
Okay.
Baby.
It very much reminds me of Bergson, Henry Bergson, a French philosopher. But he wrote about humor, he wrote about laughing. So his book, Le Rire, Laughter, was from 1900. And he really said, well, something is humorous when something mechanical is encrusted on something living. And we laugh every time a person gives the impression of being a thing. And the attitudes, gestures, and movements of the human body are laughable in proportion as that body reminds us we're machines. And you saw that happening here. Double acts and stand-up comedy. So we can distinguish between, for example, a ventriloquist and a puppet, a conversation or an interaction between these two, or between two puppets, between a human and a robot, and between robots. And we can also have some kind of collaboration in double acts and stand-up comedy between a robot and a human being as a sidekick, for example. So I'm going to Japan, especially for the Japanese audience. But first I will just shortly mention, well, what is a double act? A double act, then you have a comedy duo, you have different personalities, usually a stupid one and a clever one, or at least someone who thinks he or she is clever. So there is an uneven relationship between the partners. Well known is the white face and the August clown in circus. So the smart clown and the stupid clown, the lazy clown. Laurel and Hardy, of course, different personalities. In stand-up comedy, you have a comic style in which a comedian performs in front of a live audience. So usually speaking directly to the audience. Examples are Lenny Bruce and Eddie Murphy. So double X, human puppet interaction, the ventriloquist and the puppet, or the Punch and Judy shows where you have puppet-puppet interaction.
Are you ready, boys and girls? Yeah. Are you ready, Mr. Punch?
Yeah.
Here we go then. That wasn't very nice, Mr. Punch.
Then. Okay, then the Mansai, the double X. So it's a traditional style of stand-up comedy in Japanese culture. You can see it in TV shows. You have two performers, a straight man, the Tsukomi, and a funny man, the Boke. And they are trading funny remarks at great speed. And usually there are a lot of misunderstandings and double talk, ambiguities, puns, and other verbal gags. So here you have an example. Okay. Naoko Tosa and Ryohei Nakatsu, well, they are well known in the computer science world, in the entertainment world. Naoka. She's a media artist, and they try to, well, to simulate this human robot, this Mansai interaction, where you have a computer and where you have a human being. So you have an interactive comedy system. The user plays the role of defense, and the system plays the roles of offense. It's done by speech, so there's speech analysis of the content, the emotion, the speed and the timing, so the prosody. So the system analyzes the input of the user, and an appropriate feedback offensive phrase is chosen, and then the user speaks back. So here you have the way the choices are made, choices between a strong voice and a weak voice, or a low pitch and a high pitch. So this resembles a little the Phelan's arousal model in emotion theory. So the previous one was human robot. We can also have Mansai with robot-robot interaction. So here we have two simple robots having this interaction. Okay, some years later, 2015, a new version was built, and then, well, from newspaper articles on the web, information was extracted and it was converted into a dialogue between two robots. I'm not sure whether this research is still going on. It's interesting because this scripting that you try to extract information from newspaper articles or from, well, other material and turn it into a humorous dialogue between, let's say, a stupid and a clever robot. Another example from Yoshimoto Robotics Laboratory a few years ago. Then they had a duo comedy performance by a human and a humanoid robot. So this is the Pepper robot. You will see it later on again. So you have a robot with a human sidekick. And in this case, the jokes that were told on stage, they were, well, programmed in advance. And that was done in such a way that they looked at movements of a human joke teller. And they were implemented in the Pepper robot. And during the performance, one of the team members was, well, behind the stage, taking care of the natural movements and speech. So that was not done automatically. So Heather Knight, she was talking about silicon-based comedy. So I let her talk here. You have some.
One of our first robots, Data. He's named after the Star Trek character. I think he's going to be super popular. We've got the robot. In his head is a database of a lot of jokes. Now, each of these jokes is labeled with certain attributes. So it knows something about the subject, knows about the length, knows how much it's moving. And so it's going to try to watch your response. I actually have no idea what my robot is going to do today. So it can also learn from you about the character, the quality of its jokes, and cater things sort of like Netflix style over longer term to different communities or audiences. Children versus adults, different cultures. You can learn something from the robot about kind of the community that you're in. And also I can use each and one of you as the acting coach to our future robot companions. So some of you in this middle section, you have red, green paddles. If you like what's going on, you should do the green. If you don't like the subject or the performance, you can hold the red. Now, don't be shy. It's just a robot. It doesn't have feelings yet. And the rest of you are, you still count, you still matter. There's also a microphone that's listening to the aggregate laughter and applause and booing. I hope not, to help make some of its next decisions. Right, so let the robot stand-up comedy begin.
Hello, Ted Wigman. It's an honor to be here. You guys are looking good out there. Ready for some jokes? Woo! Here's the first one.
Okay. So this is different from the previous examples because here you have the robot audience interaction that is, well, modeled in a very simple, simple way. So there's a camera on stage looking at the audience. There are microphones and there is some explicit, well, appreciation or non-appreciation that's coming from the audience using the green or red pedals they can raise. More sophisticated is this stand-up comedian robot from Queen Mary University of London. So it's the Robo the Spion robot, a life-sized humanoid robot. And here they really had an analysis of stand-up comedians. What is their non-verbal behavior? How are they using their speed? What is the body and head orientation of these comedians? What kind of gestures do they make? And they also have some analysis of the audience. So video analysis of performances, and they annotated the non-verbal signals of stand-up comedians and also of part of the audience members. So gaze behavior is very important. Gaze shifting at the end of a sentence or between phrases or between the topic and the focus of a sentence. So gaze is important to elicit audience response. The delivery of the punchline is, of course, very important, the way that is done. So you have a faster delivery, increase of speed, the use of pauses, the use of smiles. So very short clip from this robot comedian.
Oh, yes, I'm joking.
So that was done really much more systematic, and there was more underlying research than in the previous examples, I think. Of course, non-verbal interaction during joke telling is very important, and during humorous interaction in general, the non-verbal behavior of the conversational partners is very important and has to be modeled. So we don't want something like this.
The doctor's office. The doctor tells him you need an operation. The guy says, I want a second opinion. The doctor says, okay, you're ugly, too, but old boy. Was that funny?
No.
Data, you spoiled the joke. I mean, it could have been your timing.
My timing is digital.
What? That's funny.
Why?
It would take too long to explain. Tell me another joke.
Okay, digital timing is not the preferred way of telling jokes. Of course, there's a lot of research going on nowadays on non-verbal interaction. So just 1 month ago, well, a few weeks ago, we had a conference here in Utrecht, well, also virtual, in which people talked about non-verbal behavior in relation to the content of speech. For example, I saw this movie a few weeks ago.
I started a short story about like this old alchemist who lives on top of a mountain, and then like...
Okay, so that's much more natural. And of course, what you want is not just scripted behavior, but you want to have an automatic generation of the non-verbal behavior from the text. So comedians on stage using digital technology and robots. So that's also happening. That's a very interesting development, that comedians start using digital technology in order to improve or to be more original in their performances. So three examples. So the first one is Lost Voice Guy. He is the Riddle. And he is handicapped. He is unable to speak. Nevertheless, he is performing. He's performing a comedy. And he's using a tablet, an Apple tablet. And it has a pre-programmed text. And it has pre-programmed, synthesis, voice synthesis in this tablet. And he selects the material in his performance based on the audience reaction. So here you have a very short clip again.
This point in my set, when I like to remind people that I'm not related to Stephen Hawking. I'm just a woman, if I was as clever as him once. I'm clearly not as clever as him, or I wouldn't be in this generic town or city. In fact, the closest I've ever come to being walking is when I went to see the theory of everything at the cinema.
Okay, there's a Dutch comedian, Peter Derks, he is called, and he has a drone on stage, so a flying robot, and he is playing with this drone. And the audience is very enthusiastic. You can see it here. So now he's introducing the drone to the audience, and the drone is going to make pictures of the audience. Please smile. Okay, he's interacting with the drone. And the drone wants to play.
Okay, now thank you.
Go ahead. So you can really use robot-like devices, digital technology on stage, and the audience accepts it, and you can do things. Well, you have some kind of sidekick, in fact. And you have it also in this performance of the Dutch comedian, Micha Wertheim, he is called. And he really sent a robot on stage to do a performance. And he didn't appear on stage himself. He didn't tell the audience in advance that the whole performance would be done by a robot. So there were lots of negative reactions of the audience. So we didn't pay for watching a robot performance. We want to see the human, the real comedian. During the performance, people walked away and there were some angry letters saying, well, I want my money back. On the other hand, there were lots of people who really enjoyed the performance. And later on, he did a second performance in which he was on stage together with the robot and they had some humorous interactions and conversations. So I have an example of the first performance. So here the robot is doing imitation during part of the performance. He does an imitation of the scientist Stephen Hawking. He does an imitation of the football player Johan Cruyff. And I'll show you an example of the imitation of Johan Cruyff.
En dan nu mijn super actuele imitatie van de recentelijk overleden Johan Cruyff.
Okay, you can see robots can really have performances in such a way that it's hilarious, that the audience is laughing and is enjoying the performance. So from this second performance, I also have a short clip. So the performer, the comedian, is telling a story about juggling, and then he gets interrupted by the robot who asks to be turned off. The robot is not interested anymore to be part of the performance. He feels neglected. He heard the story many times before, and he doesn't feel he is being taken seriously by the comedian on stage. So here we go.
Als ik een balletje liet verdwijnen, dan moest ik zelf eigenlijk nog meer. Dan de kinderen verbijsterd zijn over het, alsof het mij ook overkomt. Dat ik zelf overmand heb. Dat heb ik altijd moeilijker gevonden dan de vinger vlug.
Zet mij maar uit.
Turn me off.
Zet mij maar uit.
Ja.
Wat is er aan de hand dan?
Niet belangrijk.
Nou ja, wel belangrijk, want je onderbreekt mijn verhaal.
Zet mij nou maar uit.
Nee, ik ga je niet uitzetten. Dan wil ik dat je even vertelt wat er aan de hand is.
Oké, dan laat je me aanstaan.
Okay, then you leave me on. Of course, more and more robots nowadays are appearing on stage in other performances. Do they have a sense of humor? Well, if we go back to the Ruhr robots, the Karl Čapek robots, here you see them and here you see them performing part of the play from 100 years ago.
Come here, quickly. What do you want? Look at all these tubes he has got here. What does he do with them? Experiments. Do not touch. Look at this. Look what is in here. That is a microscope. Let me see. Do not touch me. Oh, now I have spilled it. What have you done? I can wipe it up. You have spoiled the experiment. Oh, it does not matter. But it is your fault. You should not have bumped into me.
Okay, again, it's fully scripted. It can be done more sophisticated. We see robots appearing during dance performances as a conductor, for example, in theater performances. On the right, this is in Warsaw, in Poland. Some people once said joke-telling robots are the final frontier of artificial intelligence. Well, I certainly disagree with that. I think robots with a sense of humor are the final frontier of artificial intelligence. And these robots, when they have a sense of humor, they should be able to recognize and understand potentially humorous situations and events. And also they should be able to create these potentially humorous situations and events. And most of all, they should know when it is appropriate to do so. So having a sense of humor is much more than just being able to tell jokes and do it in an, well, let's say, appropriate non-verbal way. So maybe we can learn from Rodney Brooks when he was working at on the Koch robot. Koch stands for cognition. And the motivation behind creating Koch was the hypothesis that humanoid intelligence requires humanoid interactions with the world. So you have to embed robots in the world. They have to interact with people or other robots in the world, and they should learn from these kinds of interactions, including humorous interactions. That's what Daniel Dennett said, the philosopher, in 1994 already. So while we are doing this, while we are at it, we might as well try to make it grave human praise and company, and even exhibit a sense of humor. So, humor research, it's not really the topic of this talk, so I'm going to conclusions now, but there is humor research. There are lots of scientific journals and books, summer schools, yearly conferences. There is strong research in joke analysis, some research on cartoons, on humorous products, on movies, comedies, side gags in movies. But all these examples, they are controlled worlds. So you can really script what is going on. There's no spontaneous humor generated by the digital technology, by the robots. Also, there is computational humor. People are working on computational humor, for example, using machine learning, extracting humorous text from web pages or proverbs from web pages. But there is hardly research in embodied humor. So humor in daily life situations. And as you know, in daily life, we don't tell many jokes. We don't hear many jokes. They are not that interesting. Nevertheless, we smile a lot and sometimes we laugh because of situations, interactions that are humorous without having a joke included in them. So humor research in general is about incongruities in objects, in persons, in situations. So we can distinguish physical incongruities, social incongruities, well, lots more. So it's interesting to do research in these kind of incongruities during daily life activities. And when we have social robots in smart environments, then hopefully we can see that they create and they support humorous events. And sometimes this can be done consciously, sometimes this can be happen accidentally, just like it's happening in real life. But nevertheless, you can really ask, how long will it take before a social robot will smile if it sees a picture like this? It's a humorous situation, and humans, well, understand what's going on. They even recognize maybe one or two of these persons. Maybe they have done this act themselves before, so they have a memory maybe of previous humorous acts. But what is necessary for a human being and also for a robot to understand the humor in a situation like this? Well, there has been a student who made a list of what is necessary to understand the humor in this situation. And I won't go through all the issues in this list, and I'm sure the list is not complete, but in fact, every item in this list is a challenge, is a research challenge. So I think we are rather far away from the moment that we can have a social robot understand a situation like this. But okay, that's research. We have to do something in the future too. Conclusions. We have seen robots, humorous robots, robots in comedy, on stage, in movies. We have seen comedians that were assisted by digital technology and by robots. We started with, the Westinghouse, one of the early performance robots, the Westinghouse robots, and we saw that even though mechanical, he'd be an improvement on a lot of our stage acts. Well, maybe that's not really visible right now, but at least you saw that people, that researchers are working on it, starting in 1928. Until Daniel Dennett said, well, if we are doing this, if we have robots embedded in social situations, then we can expect that they will exhibit, that they will learn to exhibit a sense of humor. So, conclusions. I think we can get inspiration and we can learn from science fiction movies, from stage performances, from stand-up comedy, the way that is done, but it's certainly not all. So, we can have simple script generation, we can have annotation in scripts, annotation of verbal and non-verbal behavior. We can have some human audience interaction modeling, but there is hardly a sense of humor research, sense of humor, as it is displayed in daily life situations. And to end, optimistic, but also a little modestly, future developments will profit from social robots that must interact with humans, children, for example, and human audiences in entertainment situations, on stage, in amusement situations, in amusement parks, for example, Disney parks, and in public spaces. So hopefully we see more social robots in these kind of situations, and hopefully we can go that way into a direction where some kind of sense of humor for social robots will emerge. Okay, I think this concludes my talk. Thank you very much for your attention. And of course, I'm ready, I'm available for questions.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Anton Nyalt, for your wonderful presentation. So we have one raised hand, Shahid Ansari. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Professor, I wanted to ask you that because I'm being a mechanical engineer. So my question is that in this stand-up comedy or comedy type of shows, so how much mechanical complexity is there in the robots in the future, which is required? Asking from the mechanical perspective.
At the same time, please, mention your university or working place so that we can also know who the person you are.
Yeah, I'm a PhD scholar at IIT Kanpur. I'm working in the field of robotics and automation.
Yes, thank you.
Okay. If you're working in the field of robotics and automation, and if you are in mechanical engineering, then you know a lot more about mechanical engineering, what the problems will be with these robots, than I know. So it's certainly, it's of course a question, how human-like do you want these robots to be? Maybe part of being humorous is that they are not fully human-like. So maybe we can expect that their movements and that their non-verbal behavior, that their body language remains a little, well, mechanical or clumsy or not that natural in order to make them more humorous on stage. You probably know about this uncanny effect. So when we come too close to, human behavior, and it's not really perfect, then there is a problem because people don't accept it anymore. So then it's better to have some non-human-like behavior. So this does not completely answer your questions. And maybe I should add another thing. What I didn't talk about is soft robotics. So that's a new development. So then you really can cuddle with these robots. So they're very soft, but and especially in amusement parks and for children, you want these kinds of robots to perform and to behave and to interact. But of course, also in that case, internally, you need a lot of mechanical engineering, but I'm not an expert on that.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Professor.
Okay.
Another question from Muhammad Minhajul Alam. He is a master's student of North-South University, Bangladesh. Could you please suggest some platforms or software for simulation projects on social robots?
Mm-hmm. There are platforms, there are tools for embodied agents, especially for embodied agents. So you can distinguish between research on virtual agents, embodied virtual agents, and research on robotics or on social robotics. But of course, this kind of research should converge. People working on nonverbal behavior for embodied agents and people working on nonverbal behavior for robots should collaborate. Especially in the field of intelligent virtual agents, nowadays you have platforms and you have special languages and special tools in order to describe or prescribe non-verbal behavior. And I think that some of these platforms, some of these tools, and some of these behavioral languages can be used in robotics as well. But until now, I don't think there's so much collaboration between these communities. But there are some platforms for developing, robot-like, non-verbal behavior for embodied agents, and they can be used for robots as well, I think.
Okay, any more questions? You can ask directly. Okay, so Anton, I have few questions. So I'll ask questions in between. If you have any question, just type or raise your hand. So my first question is that for the case of dementia or autistic children or elderly smartphones, especially in Japan and some other countries, they have entertainment robots so that a small robot can, welcome you in the morning and just have fun with you and have better life. How far the progress in that domain? I saw a few cases in different conferences and different programs, but
yeah. Of course, shall I answer? That's a very important application. Already maybe 10 years ago, there was this Paro robot, which was a robot seal. So it was a soft robot, as I just mentioned. And people with Alzheimer, people with dementia, people that, feel isolated, are alone at home, are really happy to have these robots, these social robots again with them. They are used for therapy, of course, but even if there is no official therapy involved, they love these robots. And of course, this is a good example where you, do not really expect that such a robot is just telling jokes. It should have some feeling of the situation, of the environment, of the mood of the patient or of the person that is owning this robot. So it should know about, it should express emotions, but it should express these emotions at the right time. So it should know about the emotions of its owner. So it's a very important application area, and it's very important, I think, that these robots know about emotions. And for me, humor is, it's the subject of the emotion called amusement. So the comic amusement emotion is something that is emerging from humorous situations, from humorous conversations. And therefore, I think these robots that are used for these therapeutic applications should, at least in conversations and in interactions, have some knowledge about humorous acts, about humorous elements that appear in conversations or that can appear in conversations.
Thank you. So we have one question from SP Ghosh. Could you please? SP Ghosh, you unmuted. You raise your hand. So okay, maybe he has voice issues. Okay, so I have one question. In slide number 37, you mentioned an example, and we know that gaze behavior, especially when in the comic time, like when you punchline, it needs emotion to offer suddenly. It's a challenging bit even for human being. So how does the robot get the feedback from the audience? Because I understand the audio is the basic information, but the video is difficult because most of the cases, the audience are in a bit darker place or many people, you cannot see the face directly and judge. Till now it's not so easy. So what are the different modalities a robot can get from the audience? And based on this, it can ensure some nice feedback. What do you
think? I fully understand the question. What's happening, I think, during a performance, but also during a presentation, when you give a presentation at a conference, then it's often the case that you just look at, well, one, two, or three different persons in the audience that really give feedback. So you don't look at all the people. You just focus when you're telling something humorous or something important, you just focus on one face, or maybe you go from one face to a second face, but you don't look at all the faces. And I think that in this example from, I think it was this university in London, the Queen Mary University, there they have a camera that is just directed to one or two persons, and they look at the facial expressions from these persons, and that is the input for the robot comedian.
Okay, thank you. So it's Bigosh, please
ask. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sure.
Sir, this is a nice speech, and we have learned a lot from your speech. Thank you very much. Okay. I have a question that what are the challenges for anthropomorphism for a hilarious robot or like a comedy and social robots? Anthropomorphism is a I think is a term in human computer interaction, you know, and actually it's like human like gesture or something. So what are the challenges in this field for anthropomorphism?
I'm not sure whether I know about the challenges, but what you saw in some of these examples and in some of these performances, that it seems to be very easy to satisfy the audience. So as soon as the robot is saying something funny or is starting to stand up or is just looking at the audience, then the audience is already laughing, and they really project a human being in this social robot. So anthropomorphism is very important. You can really make use of it. So a dog, for example, can be humorous, and that a dog is humorous is accepted. You can see it in all the cartoon movies. So the cartoons in which you have a coyote, you have a dog, or you have a cat, or you have a bird, things like that. People behave in their way of looking, understanding, perceiving what's happening. They just assume human characteristics in these animals or in mechanical devices. So I'm not sure how to answer the question about challenges for anthropomorphism, because, well, what you really want to do, at least I think most of the research you want to do, is to get rid of anthropomorphism and have the robot behave like a human being, like a full human being. I'm not sure whether that's always wise from a humor point of view, but the challenge is maybe to get rid of anthropomorphism instead of, working on it. So okay, maybe you have some ideas that you want to share with the audience, that you want to share with me about this.
No, actually, I don't have. I just saw some articles, and that's why I'm asking some questions.
Wonderful. Yes. Thank you. Okay. So, Pramit Boshak, you can ask your question.
Hello. It was a great speech.
Hi.
I will say I'm a
only a third year student of undergrad. I am not more than an enthusiast in this field, but I have a question, which is that you have shown in the later part of the video that if we show a funny picture, can a robot understand it, that it is funny or not? That's because we humans are normally understand anything funny or not from our previous experience, knowledge, etc. But if I show a picture that looks funny from me because I know the person on the picture is Barack Obama, he is doing something that he is not supposed to do. But how can a robot understand it? Could you please enlighten me?
I did not really hear the first part of your question. You were referring to a particular thing I showed, sheet I showed.
Obama just putting his feet on one of the last slides where Barack Obama put his
Okay. So and what was exactly your question in that case?
My question was, from my perspective, I know who Barack Obama is and I know what he is doing in which place. But if we want a robot to find this thing funny, he must know who the person in the image is and what he's doing. Sure. So how would you do it?
Okay. Yeah. In fact, on my sheet on the right side were a lot of things that had to do with your question. So indeed, the robot has to know about the world, has to know who is president or who was president of the United States. It has to know that sometimes people well, want to know how what their weight is, and people make jokes about other people's weight. They create funny situations. You have to know that Barack Obama sometimes invites people in his office, and he talks with them about important things. But nevertheless, Barack Obama is a humorous person. So you should also know, or you should be prepared, that sometimes he is making jokes or has funny acts. And yeah, in fact, all this knowledge, common sense knowledge, has to be modeled. And in artificial intelligence, attempts have been made in the past to model all common sense knowledge. So there are examples from early artificial intelligence in 1970s, 1980s, from Marvin Minsky or from Roger Schenck. So they were talking about frames and scripts and knowledge representation theory. There was Leonard, Dolph Leonard, who introduced Psyche, which was also a project in order to model all, common sense knowledge. But until now, hardly anything came out of these projects. So one of the things that I mentioned in the last sheet was the way Rodney Brooks, the robot researcher, is looking at interactions, and that's really about, well, put a robot in a particular situation and let him learn about what's happening in that situation and let him give feedback and interact with others in that particular situation. So that again is a start, and this robot will probably not meet Barack Obama and learn from his behavior, but nevertheless you can expect that such a robot will watch television, read newspapers maybe, and in this way get some more knowledge about the world. So it's not about explicit knowledge representation anymore, what Rodney Brooks and others are proposing, but it's learning just like a child is learning. So maybe that will be the way to go in order to improve the intelligence and the humor intelligence of social robots.
Thank you very much, Anton. Any other questions? I have, if any question, please raise your hand or ask. I have the one last question that in the slide number 41, like AGT is a winner, the lost voice guy. I mean, you mentioned that it's 100% pre-recorded, is it? Because...
No. It's he has a lot of fragments and he can choose among the fragments he has. So he cannot speak, so he really has the support of the tablet. And depending on whether the audience is laughing or not, he is choosing another fragment. And of course, he has some schedule, he has some roads, I think, some diagrams that help him to choose certain fragments. But it's not completely, the performance itself is not completely pre-programmed.
Okay, yeah, thank you. So I think that we have no questions and we, Dr. Srijan Bhattacharya, Srijan, please ask. Srijan, we can't hear your voice. Can you? Okay, so we can't get him. Maybe next time we can discuss in person. Munjur raised hand. Dr. Munjur, please ask your question.
Sir, assalamu alaikum. And thank you very much, Anton, for your wonderful speech. My question is a very simple one. As a general audience, that when you show that we are trying to find some humorous robot who can identify this and act accordingly, show gestures or do something, but what are the progresses on the other part of the emotion that some sad happenings and some sorrow things, if the robot shows some reactions on some awkward situation that it is actually a sad story or a sad feeling or some scenario like that, and it shows its humor, but which is not applicable at that moment only because the presentation of the fact is humorous. So is it still under research, or is there any progress on that part that the robot understands the speaker who is speaking to the robot is actually expressing the original scenario?
Yeah, that's a good question, of course. But what I said in one of the last sheets is the robot should know when it is appropriate to express humor. It should know when it is appropriate to smile or to laugh. And sometimes people saying emotional things that can nevertheless be understood as humorous if you take the meaning literally. And that's of course completely wrong for a robot to do. You do not have to understand, or you do not have to take sentences or behavior or even facial expressions literally, because there can be so much behind it which is not humorous at all, which is sad or tragic, etc. So there is a lot of research going on in emotion research. There's the research field affective computing. There are biannual conferences on affective computing. But my problem with this conference is, the other way around, also different from what you're asking. Usually, They are looking at the six basic emotions. So they come from Ekman and Friesen, and that is enjoyment, sadness, grief, things like that. And in general, humor is not really about the full basic emotions. It's more subtle. So I'm always talking about amusement as an emotion. And if you look at these conferences, amusement and how to deal with it is not really an issue in emotion research. So most of the research is on, well, what I said, the more explicit emotions that you can recognize more easily. Comic amusement, I think people should start working on that emotion. And comic amusement is an emotion that emerges because of humorous situations. So I fully understand your question in the sense that you should also be very careful to use humor in conversations and in interactions. You really should know what will be the effect of humor. And therefore you have to understand the emotions of the people you're interacting with.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. Even sometimes my jokes are not fully comprehended by my wife and a fight's going on. Anyway, so thank you so much. It's wonderful to have you here. And I hope to see you in person next year at ICIEV and IPPR in Japan in August.
Okay.
Yeah, but I hope that by this time, everything will be pretty normal as much as possible. And see you and wish you all the best. And thank you so much. It's a wonderful lesson from you. Yeah, it's so wonderful. Thank you so much. So with that,
thank you.
I would like to thank the participants who attended from the beginning, and also some of them came and left. Naturally, I mean, it's long, almost 92 minutes. So hopefully we see you all again. And the next presentation will be, I just share here so that you can make sure that you don't miss this one. So this is the next presentation. From Nicola Benovic. He is the director of Computational ACI Lab, University of Michigan, Ann Arbor. It will be on 27th November, Friday, Japan time 11 p.m. And Bangladesh time 8 p.m. and Eastern Standard Time 9 a.m. So Nicola Benovic is a wonderful speaker, and you can see him. I mean, he's the most handsome person, as we can see in the screen. So but we hope that on 27th you all join and inform others. With that, I'd like to thank Anton again, and would like to stop here and see you again in the future. Thank you so much. Enjoy. Stay safe. Bye-bye.